My name is Harold Shurtleff. I'm the New England coordinator for the John Birch Society. We want to welcome you to the program. I want to ask the viewers to get a note, some notebooks, pens and pencils, because there's going to be a lot of information that you may want to write down. And also, at the end of the program, there'll be a number that you may like to call to get additional information. The topic of this program is the Federal Reserve Bank. Now, many people out there have never really looked into it. And some of the information that you're going to hear tonight may be shocking. It may be even frightening. Well, we want you to understand that there is a solution to some of these terrible problems that we're facing. And so stay tuned for the solutions as well as understanding the problem. Our guest today is Mr. Ed Griffin. Mr. Griffin is the author of The Creature of Jekyll Island, which is here on the table. Mr. Griffin is a writer and documentary film producer with many successful titles to his credit. Listed in Who's Who in America, he is well known because of his unique talent for researching difficult topics and presenting them in clear terms that all can understand. Mr. Griffin is a graduate of the University of Michigan, where he majored in speech and communications. He is a contributing editor to the New American Magazine and is president of American Media, a publishing video production company in Southern California. Mr. Griffin, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you very much, Harold. I'm glad to be here.
The title of the book reminds me of a Stephen King novel, The Creature from Jekyll Island. What exactly is Jekyll Island? What or where is Jekyll Island?
Right. Well, obviously, this is a documentary, and so we're not talking about a sequel to Jurassic Park or something like that. We're talking about a place where the Federal Reserve System was actually conceived back in 1910. And it's a real island. It's off the coast of Georgia. And back in 1910, when the action began on this story, the island was completely owned by a small group of New York millionaires, the families of these millionaires, such names as J.P. Morgan and William Rockefeller. The island was called the Jekyll Island Club, and this is where the families of the super wealthy went to spend the winter months. And it's really fascinating regarding the fact that the Federal Reserve System was actually conceived at a highly secret meeting that took place on that island in 1910. And the key to understanding the Fed today is the secrecy that surrounded that meeting, because normally there's no need to have a meeting in secrecy unless there's something that you want to hide. And so, anyway, if you'd like me, I could tell you that story because it's a good lead-in to what's in this book.
Well, I think that before you do that, what is the Federal Reserve Bank?
Well, first of all, it's not a bank. And this is an interesting thing. Federal Reserve System, or bank as it's sometimes called, is not federal, which means it has nothing to do with the federal government, which comes as a big surprise to people. There are no reserves of any kind, real reserves, and it's not a system in the sense that it's a decentralization of power, which is the word, what that word was supposed to convey when they used it. And it's not even a bank, you know? So what is it? Well, the Federal Reserve System is a corporation, and it was chartered by Congress with the Federal Reserve Act in 1913. And it's a corporation which was given the franchise, the exclusive franchise, to create the nation's money. And as I said before, the federal government really doesn't run it.
So it's not a federal, it's not a reserve, and it's not a bank.
That's right.
Even though there may be 12 branches around the country, mm-hmm. these are just a facade, actually?
Well, close to it. They do form a certain technical function for clearing checks and moving money around. But the power of the Federal Reserve System has always remained in the National Board, which is headquartered in Washington. And the power of the system, as far as the Open Market Committee and the decisions make involving day-to-day operations of the Fed, really still remains in the New York so-called branch of the system, but it's more than just a branch. That's the component of the system which holds the power today.
Now, the president does appoint some Federal Reserve officials, so this may give the appearance that maybe it is indeed part of the government.
Yes, the president has the authority to appoint the national members of the board and the chairman of the board, so there is some indirect political influence mm-hmm. there. And Congress, of course, can change the rules by which the Federal Reserve operates. They can amend the charter, and if they really wanted to, they could abolish the Fed. So there is some indirect political influence. But in reality, as it operates on a day-to-day basis, it has complete autonomy, just like the Supreme Court would.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's get back to, now that we have got a little understanding of what the Federal Reserve is, let's get back to Jekyll Island and what went on there. Why the secrecy, and why doesn't the average American know this because of its profound impact on this country? It should be in every single textbook, every history book in the country. When I was going to high school, junior high school, I heard about a Federal Reserve Bank, but that's all I knew. I did nothing about this Jekyll Island. So,
right. Well, you weren't supposed to know about it, really, because when I also went to school, I didn't learn any of this. It was only when I got into the research phase of it, and then I realized that there's a lot going on out there that doesn't meet the eye, you know. And by the way, none of this is really that hard to find. It's in the public record if you're willing to dig for it. You can find most of this information in your major public libraries. But in any event, here's the story. It was 1910, which, remember, is about 3 years before the Federal Reserve System was actually passed into law. So this is a three-year jump on it. And it was in that year that a group of seven very powerful financiers gathered in secret at Jekyll Island to create the concept of the Federal Reserve System. And every one of these concepts eventually was embodied in the Federal Reserve Act. And the way they gathered is really interesting. Here's what happened. It was November of 1910 when Senator Nelson Aldrich, who was the Republican whip in the Senate at that time, sent his private railroad car to the New Jersey railroad station. And he and six of these others gathered there to get on that car and travel southward to Georgia, to Jekyll Island. And those seven men had been told to come very secretly, not to be seen together, not to talk to each other, to shun newspaper reporters if they ran into them. And they all would have been recognized by any newspaper reporter had they been spotted.
These were some very prominent people.
Oh, very prominent people. And if you like, I can give you their names in a moment. One of the attendees came carrying a shotgun in a traveling case. So if he had been asked where he was going, he could say that he was going duck hunting. But the fact of the matter is that man had never fired a gun in his life, you know, part of the deception. And when they got on board this private railroad car, they were told to use their first names only, not to use their full names. In fact, a couple of these people abandoned their first names completely and used code names to talk to each other. And the reason for that is that they were concerned that the servants on the train, the train crew, would recognize them and that they might talk, and then the word would get out and the secrecy would be exposed. Well, they traveled southward, a 1,000-mile journey in this car. They wound up in Brunswick, Georgia. They took the ferry across the inland straits and they wound up at the Jekyll Island Club. Now, I went to Jekyll Island just recently when I came back here in the East Coast to check it out. And I thought, since I was supposed to be an expert on this topic, I'd at least see Jekyll right. Island. And it looks exactly like I thought it would from reading the record. There was a very elaborate clubhouse there, very luxurious. And it's still there, by the way. It's been restored by the state of Georgia. And there are a lot of buildings there, what they called cottages, where some of these families had built their summer homes. Well, they didn't look like cottages to me. They were mansions, magnificent, magnificent homes. But in any event, at this time of this meeting, the island was empty because that was November and the season started in January, so there were just a few maintenance people there. It was an ideal place to have a confidential meeting. So these seven men went to the clubhouse, and for 9 days they sat around a table and they debated, they argued, they spoke, they compared notes, and they drafted the essential form of what became the Federal Reserve System. Then they came back to New York, and they disappeared back into Wall Street, and for quite a few years afterward, they denied that such a meeting took place. And then later, as it became known that some of them had been there, they said, well, yes, but we just gathered to talk about banking matters and play cards and that kind of thing. And then eventually, after the Federal Reserve System was firmly established and everybody revered it as an American institution, then they began to speak openly about the meeting and what happened and what they did. They wrote books on the topic. Some of them wrote magazine articles, and they gave interviews to newspaper reporters. And at this late date, we're able to piece together that story. Well, why the secrecy? As you just asked a moment ago, there was a very good reason for it. At the time, 1910 through 1913, there was a great concern among the American people over the concentration of wealth into the hands of a very few families, and furthermore, they were concerned over the concentration of financial power into the hands of a few investment firms on Wall Street. They called that group the Money Trust at the time, and so there was a hue and cry in Congress for legislation to break the grip of the Money Trust over the nation's markets. Well, the bill that was offered to break the grip of the Money Trust, as we see, was written by the Money Trust.
By the Money Trust.
So you see what a scam it was. Had this been known that these were the men that were drafting the so-called reform legislation, why then no one would have accepted their bill.
It would have been dead on before it even got to
Congress. Dead on arrival, absolutely. So that was the basic need for the secrecy. There were other things involved. I don't know whether I should get into that first. Would you like to know who was at that meeting?
I think a few names would
yeah,
be.
I'm dying to tell you, actually, because what I'm saying sounds so far-fetched that without a little bit of documentation, it would be literally unbelievable. Now, we know who those men are now because they admitted it. In fact, they boasted about it in later years. There were seven of them. The first one I mentioned was Senator Nelson Aldridge.
That sounds familiar.
That sounds familiar.
Yes.
The name Aldridge? Sure. Yeah. Remember Nelson Aldridge Rockefeller?
Rockefeller, yes.
Okay, that's the family tie. Senator Aldridge was the chairman of the National Monetary Commission, which was the committee created by Congress for the purpose of proposing reform legislation for the purposes I just mentioned.
So basically his job was to make sure these guys, to keep them in line, ostensibly.
Well, yes, that's like asking the wolf to build a defense around the chicken coop.
Yes.
But anyway, he was in charge of the National Monetary Commission. He was a business associate of J.P. Morgan. He was the father-in-law of John D. Rockefeller, Jr., which means that eventually he became the grandfather of Nelson Aldridge Rockefeller, who became our vice president. Okay, he was the first one there. Then there was Abraham Piat Andrew, who at that time was the assistant secretary of the Treasury. Frank Vanderlip was there. He was the president of the National City Bank of New York, which at that time was the largest of all the banks in the country, the largest one in New York, the most powerful banking institution, literally, that there was anywhere in the country. And he represented the financial interests of William Rockefeller and Kuhn Loeb and Company. Okay? Henry Davison was there. He was the senior partner of J.P. Morgan Company. Okay? Charles Norton was present. He was the president of the First National Bank of New York, another one of the giants. Benjamin Strong was present. He was head of J.P. Morgan's Bankers Trust Company. And incidentally, he later became the first head of the Federal Reserve System 3 years later. And finally, there was a fellow by the name of Paul Warburg, very interesting character. He was born in Germany, later became a naturalized American citizen. He was a partner in Kuhn Loeb & Company. He represented the Rothschild banking dynasty in England and in France. And his brother was Max Warburg, who was the head of the Warburg Banking Consortium in Germany and the Netherlands. Paul Warburg was one of the wealthiest men in the entire world. And for those people who are Little Orphan Annie fans, they may remember that in that cartoon strip there was a character called Daddy Warbucks. Well, Paul Warburg was the real Daddy Warbucks, after whom that caricature was named. And I have a picture of Warburg in my book, and if you want to compare his photograph to the drawing of Daddy Warbucks, you can see quite a similarity.
So these folks weren't just bank tellers.
No,
we're talking
about
perhaps one-fourth of the world's wealth was represented
That's
at that
right.
meeting there.
That's right. One-fourth of the wealth of the entire world
That's
was
incredible.
Represented by these seven men. This was, in fact, the money trust.
That's incredible. Now, why did they establish a Federal Reserve Bank? Things were going pretty well. We had a pretty growing economy before then. So why was there a need to even establish one?
Well, that's right to the point, Harold, because it's easy to see why if the bankers are the big bankers now, we're talking about the mega banks, not the little banks, because the little banks are the ones that are getting squeezed out by mm-hmm. this whole process. It's easy to understand why they would want to write their own reform legislation in order to deflect it so that it might not affect them. But they had something else in mind. And when you look at that list of men who were there, there's something really interesting about it. Here we had the Rockefellers, we had J.P. Morgan, we had the Warburgs, Kuhn Loeb and Company, the Rothschilds. You know, these were all competitors. Well, when competitors get together and come to an agreement, you better have a lot of coffee in you, because you better be on your toes. Is something going down here? What is it? Well, to answer your question very succinctly, it's a cartel. A cartel was being formed. The Federal Reserve System is a cartel, a banking cartel, and that was created on Jekyll Island, and the Federal Reserve Act is the cartel agreement, which was enforceable now by law. Now, a cartel is a grouping of independent businesses which come together for the purpose of reducing or eliminating competition between themselves to enhance their profits. And they do this by fixing prices or dividing up market share or agreeing that this member of the cartel will produce that product and somebody else will produce another one and they won't compete, or services of this kind. Dividing it up, avoiding competition so they can charge more for their products and services. Of course, the other side of that coin is that the public winds up paying more for those products and services. And banking cartels are no different than any other kind.
Like the oil cartel that
oil
we
cartels.
Knew so much about yeah. during the so-called energy crisis of the 70s.
Exactly.
The evil yeah. Arabs. But here we have a cartel that's probably mm-hmm. more powerful and influential.
That's right. So the reality is that the Federal Reserve System is the embodiment of a banking cartel that was hammered together as early as 1910 in secret at this meeting on Jekyll Island.
Now, if you read a textbook, I went to college, I took economics, and we said, what I learned was that the capitalist system really can't work by itself, and these greedy, evil bankers need to be kept in check. So to protect the people, we need a Federal Reserve System. But in reality, it was the same people who were behind this, running the banks, that wanted this to protect their own interests.
That's right.
And uh-huh. we see examples like that today in politics. We see that all the time. One party proposes something, the other party will hoot and holler, and next thing you know, they propose a very similar measure.
Mm-hmm. But they're the moderates. And they're
moderate.
Yeah, they're rushing toward totalitarianism at a slower pace,
pace.
So therefore they're the good guys.
For example, if there's a $100 billion foreign aid package that, let's say, the Democrats, the Republicans say, that's ridiculous. $50 billion sounds pretty reasonable.
Yeah, right.
And within 2 or 3 years, you've got the $100 billion package
yeah.
after all.
Right. Well, I'd like to comment on that, Harold, because this business of blaming capitalism for all of the ills of the financial markets is a very deceitful thing. I learned the same thing, and it was very confusing to me. What I didn't learn in school is that the word capitalism is not an adequate word to describe this process. Capitalism, in its generic sense, merely means the private ownership of property. Well, that leaves the question unanswered as to how one obtains that ownership of property. The process of obtaining it is a critical issue which is never looked at. Now, those like myself who believe in competition would be classified as free enterprise capitalists. I believe that you should acquire and own property if you work for it and you compete for it fairly. And that means you have to offer better products and services at lower prices in order to acquire your capital, in order to make your money. I like the idea that people can get rich in serving other people through the competition system. And that's free enterprise capitalism. But now we're looking at people like J.P. Morgan and Rockefellers. That's a whole different group. Those are the monopoly capitalists. They don't believe in competition at all. They devote their lives to the elimination of competition. It was John D. Rockefeller the first who said, competition is a sin. And he believed it. And these people do everything they can to reduce or eliminate competition, and they often get government into the contract to enforce their cartel agreements. So the monopoly capitalists are the ones with the most capital, but they do so by avoiding competition and bringing government in to enforce the cartel agreements. That's why the big monopoly capitalists are always in bed with politicians.
What is the history of banking? Now, I know we don't have the time to go into banking in the Roman Empire, let's say, but let's look at the United States. Have we ever had any other type of central bank when a country was founded? And, of course, I read your book, and you have a good little chapter on the history of banking. You talked about Andrew Jackson and what he was trying to do and the Civil War. So could you try to address, maybe give us a brief overview of the United States, the history of banking in the United States?
In 30 seconds or less, I'll see what I mean. Well, it is quite an interesting history. And here again, it's similar to this misconception about capitalism. We were told one thing, but it's really not quite that way. I remember learning in school that we had anarchy in banking in our history. There were booms and busts and crashes and depressions and profiteering on the parts of the banks. And therefore, we needed government regulation to prevent that from happening. Well, I found out when I dug into it that that's a half-truth. And, of course, half-truths are the most dangerous of all. In fact, they're the biggest lies because they're so appealing. What we find is that banking, no time in history has been unregulated by government. We have never had, at least in this country is for certain, we have never had true free banking. Banking has always been regulated by some level of government, if not the federal government, at least by the state governments. And along with this regulation, which has been offered supposedly to protect the people, always offered that way, of course, we find that the real purpose of the involvement of government with the banks is to protect the banks. It allowed the banks to create money out of nothing and to funnel that newly created money into the state governments. And of course, since the banks were then partners with the governments, then when the banks got into trouble because of this process, the governments would have to come to the aid of the banks because they're their buddies, their partnership in this thing. And so we find throughout American history, little banks getting into political partnership with state governments, which were working together, inflating the money supply to create money for the states, and then the banks would default on their promises to the stock, to the depositors, and wouldn't pay them on demand. There were runs on the bank, the banks would collapse, and so forth. This whole history of chaotic banking in America, and there is quite a history of it, is traceable not to the fact that it was free banking, but to the fact that it was government regulation of banking and therefore protecting the banks that created it. And so since we didn't know that in school, we thought, oh, free banking will never work. Look what it did, you see. We never had free banking. So then when the Federal Reserve System came along in 1913, they said, well, you see, this is chaotic banking. If you don't have government regulation, so therefore we must have federal government regulation. And it was just applying more and more of the problem supposedly advertised as the cure. Mm-hmm. Now, it used to be that banks would expand and contract as the money supply was expanding and contracting at a state level. And that was disastrous enough because it could throw a whole geographical area into a state of depression. But now that we have the Federal Reserve System, it happens at a national level, you see. So it used to be that one region might fail, but everybody else was in good shape. Now the whole nation is at danger.
Thanks to the Fed, Federal
Thanks
Reserve
to the Fed,
Bank.
Going down at one time.
Mm-hmm. Important question. What is inflation? Now, I remember in the mid-70s, during this Whip Inflation Now campaign that was under the Ford administration, that if we took public transportation and ate peanut butter sandwiches instead of eating meat, closed our windows and turned our thermostats down to 65 degrees, and did all these wonderful things, clipped coupons out of newspapers that we would whip inflation. And as a, I think it was in junior high school at the time, I thought, boy, this is a pretty good thing. We ought to do these things. It's pretty patriotic to do this. And as I learned what inflation, and of course you define it very well, I thought I was very foolish and stupid for falling for the trap. That it was just a lot of publicity stunt, a lot of puff to get people off the real reason. So could you tell us what inflation is and what it isn't?
I'll start with the bottom line. Inflation is a tax. Inflation is a hidden tax. Inflation is a hidden tax on the American people, which they do not know that they're paying, and that tax is going to the federal government. And here's how it works. This is that process by which money comes into creation. Remember, we're dealing here with a mechanism which is essentially a partnership between the government and the private banks, the big private banks, now not the little banks. They're involved at their own detriment, unfortunately. You know, may have noticed that the little banks are getting squeezed out.
Yes.
Yeah, and more it's centralization in New York. But nevertheless, here's how it works. It starts with Congress. Congress needs money. They always need lots of money. So they go to the Treasury and they ask for some money, and the Treasury says, hey, we don't have any. We don't have any left. You guys took it all. By February 15th, it was all gone. Everything we took in taxes, you guys spent already. Congress has never stayed within its tax budget. So they say, don't worry about that. They go down the street to the printing office and they get a little certificate printed up, and it's got curlicues around it, and it says United States Treasury bond or note. And there's a big seal at the bottom of it, and if you hold up the light, it really says IOU. That's what it is. It's a potential IOU. So then they take it down to the Federal Reserve, and they offer it through their dealers, special dealers that are franchised by the Fed, to sell these IOUs to the public. Well, the public steps forward and takes a lot of them, but usually not enough. There are always some left over. So they say not to worry. The ones that they can't sell to the public, they go down the street a little bit further to the Federal Reserve System. And the Fed's been waiting for them, because that's why the Fed is in this partnership. When the Treasury official shows up, the officer of the Fed opens up his bottom drawer, pulls out this big checkbook, and he writes a check to the United States Treasury, $1 billion or whatever the amount is, and hands the check to the Treasury official. Now, we just stop for a second and ask, what's this checkbook? What account did that come from? Where did the money come from that they used to give to the Treasury? And the amazing answer is that there is no account. There is no money. This $1 billion was created at the instant that check was written and given to the Treasury. Created out of thin air. Okay? So now, Congress likes this process a lot because they don't have to worry about taxes anymore. No matter what they want, it's available from the Fed. Created out of nothing, you see. You may have noticed that Congress hasn't worried about what anything costs in a long, long time. Doesn't make any difference. The Fed is standing by to generate that amount of money.
That's interesting. Well, we're going to end this portion of the program, and we're going to continue. So please stay tuned to part two, and we will further go into this inflation. Thank you for joining us. Welcome to part two of our program on the Federal Reserve Bank. My name is Harold Shurtleff. I'm the New England coordinator for the John Birch Society, and with me today is our guest, Mr. Edward Griffin. He is the author of The Creature from Jekyll Island, A Second Look at the Federal Reserve Bank, and of course a copy of his book is prominently displayed on the table here. On part one of the program, we were discussing quite a lot, but we left off with inflation. Mr. Griffin was giving us a definition of inflation. So we'll just let him continue where he left off.
Fine. Well, we were talking about how money comes into being through the Federal Reserve System, and I described the fact that when Congress needs more money than it can collect through taxes or that it can borrow from the public, it doesn't really have any great concern about a shortfall, because all it has to do is go down the street to the Federal Reserve System, and the Fed literally writes a check for any amount of money. In this case, we were using an example of a $1 billion check, to the Treasury, gives it to the Treasury, and there is absolutely nothing behind that check. There is no account. There is no money of any kind.
No gold?
No gold,
no
nothing.
Silver.
Nothing. All there is really is a piece of paper that says check. I mean, that's it. It's just a piece of paper. And they exchange the little piece of paper that says check for the other piece of paper that says bond.
A little bigger than this.
A little bigger, but they're just pieces of paper that cross hand, and voila, through the modern of the technology of the Federal Reserve System, we've just created $1 billion, you see.
Incredible.
So this billion comes into existence out of nothing. They give it to the Treasury, and now it really gets interesting. The Treasury takes the $1 billion check and deposits it into its checking account, into a Federal Reserve Bank. And then the numbers show up in the ledger showing that the government now has $1 billion to spend. So it starts to write checks against its own account, smaller checks. You know, it may send $100 million to some foreign dictator, or it may send a lot of money to the United Nations or pay off the International Monetary Fund. It may pay for a military excursion against some country. It may buy a lot of votes by providing benefits, you know, all those things that are essential for the American government to do. Or in this case, just to follow it through to see how money comes into being, let's just assume that some of the money goes to the federal employees, which of course it does. In this case, let's say he's a post office worker. And to make it simple, we'd say that the guy working for the post office gets a check from his employer, the federal government, for $100, just to make it simple. Now, he's very happy. He's got his check for $100. He doesn't have the foggiest idea that just a few days ago that $100 didn't exist anywhere in the world. And he doesn't care, really. He's got it. It's spendable. So he takes it home, gives it to his wife. She's happy. She deposits it into their checking account so they can pay for the groceries. And the bank that gets it now, the local bank, now has $100 in its account, which it didn't have before. And now this is where it gets good. The bank opens up its loan window, and it says, welcome, everybody. We have money to loan because of this $100 that just got deposited. And the people line up for the loan. Now, how much money would you assume that they are able to loan? The $100 that the woman just deposited? No. They can loan $900. Oh, that makes a lot of sense. $900. How? Because the Federal Reserve System is written in such a way and constructed in such a way that the banks must hold only 10% in reserve of all the money that they have out there. Well, the bank takes that $100 check that was deposited and puts it under a column that says reserves. Now that it has $100 in reserves, and they only need 10% reserves, $100 is 10% of $1,000. They've got the $100 back, so now they can lend out $900. So the fellow comes up, wants to borrow $900 for a used car. The bank whips out its checkbook, or applies the credits directly to the account of the borrower, for $900. And the question is, where did that money come from? What was behind that checkbook? And the answer is the same as with the Federal Reserve System. There is absolutely no money there prior to that. The $900 is created totally out of thin air.
So at the local savings bank where I do business, that same scenario happens?
Well, we're talking about federal banks now involved with the Federal Reserve System. Mm-hmm. Now, sometimes when you get further removed from that and you get into savings and loan associations, the money that they loan out is primarily the money that's put into them by savings, savers, depositors. But we're talking about the primary banking mechanism, mm-hmm. the commercial banks, which are part of the Federal Reserve System. And remember what I said before, this is a cartel. Mm-hmm. And this is what the cartel was formed to do, to make this thing legal. You know? We would go to jail for this kind of thing. But they are allowed to do it because they're in partnership with the government. And it's a scam.
I remember growing up as a young boy, my father had a little small drugstore. And in the late 60s, I was told that there are certain coins after 1964 or later or sooner that they'd be worth a little bit more than the coins that are coming out in 65 and 66. And the half dollars that were minted before 64 also were some money. Now, I noticed, I said, why is that? Well, of course, silver. They were all silver. What happened to that silver What happened to that gold? I used to be a coin collector, and I remember seeing these silver certificates, little bills, or little, not bills, but little dollars that said that there was somewhere waiting, that if you bring this to a bank, there'll be an ounce of silver for you. And the same thing with a gold certificate. I think there were $20 gold certificates. We'll pay to the bearer on demand $20 worth of gold. Well, what happened to this? At least at that point, we know that that little piece of paper represented something. Where today, it just says that all money's legal tender. Mm-hmm. What happened?
Well, yes, the Federal Reserve notes we carry now, if you take them into the Treasury and demand that they be, exchanged for something, you get more Federal Reserve notes back, because they're just, they're not backed by anything anymore. And you pointed up a very important thing, which is that in the earlier days of our country, our true money was backed by silver primarily, and to some extent by gold, which means that the government and the banks could not just create it out of nothing. They were limited by the amount of gold and silver there was available. And they didn't like that at all. I mean, this just cramped their style tremendously. You know, if you can write a check for $10,000, if you can write checks all day long, $10,000, $20,000, $50,000, $100,000, and you don't have any money in your checking account and you can loan it out at 8% interest, you know, that's a pretty good arrangement. But if you have to have real gold and silver in your vault before you can lend money out, it slows you down quite a bit. And so the politicians and the bankers hate a money that's backed by gold or silver because it crimps their profit potential. So the whole history of this unholy alliance that I'm talking about between the political scientists and the monetary scientists who worked this all out in secret on Jekyll Island, the whole history of their endeavor has been to break the American dollar away from gold and silver so that they could have freedom to create as much of it as they wish. So the bottom line is that today there is no backing to our dollar. The only limitation on how much can be created is the restraint and good judgment of the men who are running these things.
Behind it.
Yeah.
It's interesting. I had a former co-worker who was raving about Roosevelt and how the gold was a terrible thing, it was destroying our economy. So the next day I walked in with some paper. I cut him the size of dollar bills, and I asked him if he had any gold coins or any old silver dollars, a half dollar. He said, oh yeah. And I presented him with this paper, and I said, I want them. He looked at me and he says, oh, come on now. I said, yesterday you told me that this was paper was better than gold and silver, yet he wouldn't take my paper.
Right. Well, of course, he was talking about paper money that was backed by the full faith of the United States government and all that nonsense.
Not backed by Harold Shurtleff.
No, not backed by Shurtleff. Well, that's an interesting thing, the full faith and credit of the United States government, and the people they like to throw that phrase out because it sounds like, well, if our money is backed by the full faith and credit of the United States government, what more could you ask for? Well, what is the full faith and credit of the United States government? When you analyze it, what it really means is that the government stands by in readiness to tax you, to take everything you've got in order to make payment of interest on that government debt. To pay you your interest, they're standing by to take from you everything you have. That's the full faith and credit. Yeah, they give you back a little bit of what they take from you. And people don't realize that that's what that means. It's like you've got a hungry dog, so the poor dog, you want to feed it, you chop off its tail and feed it to the grateful animal, you know?
Okay. The founder of the John Birch Society, Robert Welch, wrote an essay back in the 60s. It was called, What is Money? And he identified, he gave us the definition of money. And it was always something that was acceptable, that had relative scarcity. And he went on to say that cows and cattle were used as exchange. But what types of money are there? Because what we call these bills in our pocket, money, it's not really money, is it?
No, it's not really money. And you can get kind of esoteric on this, but it boils down to the fact that you've got real money or you don't. Real money is something which has intrinsic value. And it could be cows. As a matter of fact, our word pecunia, a pecuniary interest, for example, meaning a monetary interest, comes from the Latin word for cow, and that was the money. People exchanged cows. But throughout history, the one substance of intrinsic value that has always been selected through trial and error as the ultimate money has been gold or silver, precious metals, mm-hmm. for good reason. We don't need to go into all of them here, but they're just obvious. Cows get sick. Cows die of old age. Then what happened to your money? Well, it just died, you know? Whereas gold and silver is, it doesn't deteriorate. It doesn't die. It doesn't get sick. It doesn't wear out.
You can't put many cows in your wallet.
You can't put many cows in your wallet. That's right. You have great concentration in small quantity. You can take a big gold coin and melt it down and make two little ones. You can't cut a cow in half and still, you know, a lot of reasons why coins became, and precious metals became, the ultimate money supply. And this happened all over the world. You know, you can find a few exceptions, but the history, the lesson of history, is that gold and silver coins has been the natural money. Now, then it gets confusing because, well, where does paper come in? The true paper money was a receipt for the gold coin. People were worried about protecting their coins. It's easy to steal that. Of course, you can steal paper too, but they didn't want to carry around all this heavy coinage. And so they would take it to a warehouse, or usually to a jeweler who had gold anyway in the vault for their jewelry, and pay them to guard their gold supply. And so this was the beginning of banking in its simplest form. You would take your coins to somebody and say, please guard it for me. Yeah. And the person who said yes, the warehouseman or whatever you want to call it, would give you a written receipt, said, I have five gold coins of yours. They belong to you, and this is my receipt. Anytime you bring that receipt back, I guarantee you that I will give you back your coins. So now you had a piece of paper that said it was worth five gold coins. After a while, people began to exchange those receipts rather than going back to the warehouse and getting their coins and exchanging the coins and then going back and getting receipts again. It was simpler just to exchange the paper receipts. And this is how paper money came into being. It was useful because everyone knew that that paper receipt, they recognized the signature and the seal of the jeweler or the warehouse that had the coin. They knew that they could take it anytime they wanted to and get the real gold. That's what gave the paper its value. Mm-hmm. Well, of course, that's long ago. Now we have the paper, and we have all the trappings. We've got the signatures and the seals and all the fancy stuff.
Looks good. Looks official.
It looks great, but you can't take it anywhere and get your gold back. It's worthless.
Hmm. In your book, you wrote something that was quite startling, something that I should have been aware of, but I just never thought of it. You said that if all the debt was paid off, there wouldn't be any money in circulation. And I thought, well, gee, when I get a bill in the mail, phone bill, whatever, I don't go out and spend that. I don't feel too good. I say, oh, my heavens, I got to pay the bill, or I'm going to have my people coming down on me, creditors coming down on me. Explain that.
Well, we said earlier that we talked about how money came into existence. Remember, the fellow comes to the loan window at the bank, and he wants to borrow money for his car, and the banker whips out his checkbook and creates the money out of nothing. That's how the money gets into the system. Now, if he were to come back to the window and say, I'm paying back my loan, and he gives the $900 back to the banker, that money goes out of existence, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
It was nothing when it started, and when it's paid back, it's now, again, nothing.
Nothing.
And all of our money is based on that concept. Every dollar, every penny of it, was created at the point that it was loaned to someone. So if all of the debt of the nation were paid back, all of those dollars would disappear back into the inkwells and back into the computer chips, and there wouldn't be one penny left in circulation, which is an incredible situation to have. What a basis for a monetary system. You see, what that means is that Congress cannot, absolutely cannot, pay off the national debt, cannot get the government out of debt without destroying our monetary system. Even if Congress wanted to, which, believe me, it doesn't, Even if it had the resources, if it had the tax revenue, if it had the surplus, it dare not pay off the national debt because it would absolutely destroy the economy of the country by taking all money out of circulation. You see what a mess we got ourselves
into.
Something
else that was kind of startling, you made reference to a very obscure, or at least I've never heard of the man before, Beardsley Rummel, I believe was his name. He did something that profoundly affects all Americans to this day. He was the one that devised the pay-as-you-go system, the withholding tax.
Yeah, withholding taxes so that Americans would not feel the pinch of having to pay their taxes quite so much.
That was just, in my opinion, genius.
That was very smart.
But he authored an article in a magazine a few years after World War II, and he said that basically we do not have to tax money to raise revenue.
That
sounds pretty good. Let's do away with taxes. Then he went on to explain, no, we still want taxes, and this is why. And could you please elaborate as to why we need to have taxes?
Yeah, that's a really revealing article. It was written shortly after World War II came to a close. And basically, Rummel was saying that the United States no longer needs to raise money through taxes, period. Why have taxes? Because they can get all the spending money they need through this hidden tax called inflation. They can get everything they want from the Federal Reserve System, who just writes those checks and creates it out of nothing. That's all they need. Well, then why have taxes? And his answer was most interesting. He said, well, it was useful for the redistribution of wealth. It was useful for the political reward system. In other words, you could take money from some people through tax incentives, you know, and tax deductions. You can favor one block of voters over another. You can buy votes with the income tax system. It's a system of political power over people. That's why they want taxes. And I would add one more thing to it, which Rummel didn't say in his article, and that is that if they didn't have income taxes and excise taxes out there visibly for people to see that they're paying taxes, then they might think, well, wait a minute, how's the government getting the money? And they'd start looking around and they'd see that they were getting it from inflation, the hidden tax. And that won't do because the public can't figure that one out. Because when they once figure that out, these congressmen are in serious trouble.
So when they talk about tax the rich or tax this group or tax that group, it's really just a facade.
It's a grandstand play.
And of course, it seems to be that the rich aren't really the rich at all because the super rich are the ones that are generally behind all this.
Yeah. This whole scheme was put together by, as you say, the super, super rich. And they're not the least bit concerned about taxes. Even if they pay large taxes, don't forget, they control the mechanisms of power. They control the banks. They control, I'm sorry to say, to a large extent, the levers of political power as well.
You have a chapter in the book entitled A Pessimistic Scenario. We want to end this program on a positive note. But if we allow this to continue, if we can't get enough Americans informed, what may or what will probably happen to this country?
It is a very pessimistic view as I see it. What we're headed for, Harold, as I see it at least, is what they're now calling the New World Order. That's an expression that describes world government through the United Nations. And it's not just any world government that we're looking at. I have no problem with the concept of a world government in which all nations come together in peace and brotherhood and respect each other's traditions and cultures and religious views. But that is not the kind of world government that we're headed into. Not any old kind of government is going to work. I mean, Hitler had world government in mind, and we could see right away that that's not what we wanted. So we need to ask questions. What kind of world government is this going to be? And it's very clear that this United Nations, made up with all these little tin-horn dictatorships from around the world, the bottom denominator of that world government is a totalitarian political system. And we are to be merged into that and completely swamped by the majority of the world. We will lose our cherished political freedoms. Our constitutional concepts are bye-bye. I mean, our standard of living is gone, and we can see that happening now. They're trying to bring us down to the level of a third world country. And that way they can control us. The goal that they seek is just to merge us into kind of a melting pot of mediocrity. It's what I call high-tech feudalism. That's where we're headed, and I can assure you we don't want it.
What happened in Bretton Woods, and this is the 50th anniversary, 1994, of Bretton Woods, another type of one of these secret meetings where the American people didn't, there was no consensus. There was just some very powerful people got together, and next thing you know, well, of course, our standard of living has changed dramatically. So a little bit on Bretton Woods, if you could.
Well, Bretton Woods was a conference sponsored by the United Nations shortly after the end of World War II. And it was where all of the finance ministers and departments of finance from all the countries of the United Nations came together and held this meeting at Bretton Woods. And it was called the Monetary Conference. And they created the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund and agreed upon certain principles of international monetary cooperation, as they called it. The objective of that whole process was to separate all the monies of the world from gold or silver, to put the entire world on a fiat money basis so that the politicians and the international banking cartel could create money out of nothing on a worldwide basis. It was all laid out, the strategy was laid there, the mechanism was created at that point. Of course, the real target was the United States dollar, because at that point, the United States and I guess Switzerland were about the only two countries that really had any precious metals behind their monetary system. And even ours was just partially backed. They had already chopped it away to about three-fourths gone. It was only about a quarter backed. But they had to get rid of that last 25% also. Basically, that's what happened at Bretton Woods, and it was the two masterminds there were John Maynard Keynes, who was a socialist from England, and Harry Dexter White. They were considered to be the theoreticians. Harry Dexter White was a communist, actually. He was a secret communist at the time working in our own government.
Give us some solutions. In your book, you laid out 14. We don't want all 14 right now, but give us a few things that we could do.
Yeah, there are actually 16 steps that I could see that we should go through to convert our present fiat money to a sound monetary system. But basically, the three major milestones that I think we have to pass in that process is, number one, we have to reestablish a real dollar. A dollar as defined in our Constitution is not a piece of paper unbacked by anything. The word dollar comes from the French, I mean, not from the French, from the Dutch word, thaler. Mm. That was a Dutch coin that circulated in the colonies at the time our Constitution was written. It was a coin of universal quality, universal weight. Everybody could trust it. And it was our de facto money at that time. So they just said, that's our money supply. So it's now the money supply of the United States. The thaler became the dollar. The dollar is defined by law as a coin with a specified silver content of certain purity and weight. We have to get back to that.
Back to that.
That's number one. Number two, we have to phase out these things called Federal Reserve notes. And the third step is to pay off the national debt.
And I think, in closing, I think we should abolish the Federal Reserve Bank.
Yeah.
Yes. Viewers are urged to contact us at this at the 800 number that will be at the end of the program. And again, we thank you for joining us tonight, and we look forward to your inquiry. Thank you very much.